is your faithfulness to me. Great is your faithfulness to me. From the rising sun to the setting, same I will praise your name. Great.
Welcome to our service from Hillsborough Parish Church. It is great that you've decided to tune in today so we can worship the Lord together. And as we worship a risen living Lord, let us begin our service with the Easter greeting. Christ is risen. The Lord is risen indeed. Alleluia. But before we sing, let us pray. Father, we come before you as we are. You search our hearts. All our desires are known, and nothing is hidden from you. May you have mercy upon us. Grant us your grace and really speak to our hearts and souls today. May our gratitude for your great love rise up within us, and may we lift up and glorify your mighty name. And we pray this by your Spirit and in the name of Jesus. Amen. We have the most wonderful, amazing God. So let our thanks and praise pour out for the 10,000 reasons we have for our hearts to sing. So we sing, "Bless the Lord, O my soul."
Bless the worship his holy name. Sing like never before, oh my soul, I worship your holy name. The sun comes up, it's a new day dawning. It's time to sing your song.
His soul.
can be so easy for us to make a mistake, to sin, and then to feel so guilty that we avoid spending any time with the Lord in prayer and indeed even maybe even coming to church. But when we gather together, even through this online service, we have the opportunity to get right with the Lord, to bring everything to his throne of grace. And when we are truly sorry, we receive his forgiveness. So whatever you are carrying today, bring it and leave it at the foot of the cross of Jesus Christ. So let us say together, Almighty God, our Heavenly Father, we have sinned in thought and word and deed, and in what we have left undone. We are truly sorry and we humbly repent. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, have mercy on us and forgive us, that we may walk in newness of life to the glory of your name. Amen. May God, the righteous judge, remove your sins from you and wash you whiter than snow. May he give you a pure heart. May he strengthen you and renew your spirit. May he restore you to his presence and give you the joy of his salvation. Through Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. And now Claire is going to bring us our Bible reading.
Our reading today is taken from Genesis chapter 11, verse 27 to 12, verse 9. This is the account of Terah's family line. Terah became the father of Abram, Nahor, and Haran. And Haran became the father of Lot. While his father Terah was still alive, Haran died in Ur of the Chaldeans in the land of his birth. Abram and Nahor both married. The name of Abram's wife was Sarai, and the name of Nahor's wife was Milcah. She was the daughter of Haran, the father of both Milcah and Ishka. Now Sarai was childless because she was not able to conceive. Terah took his son Abram, his grandson Lot, son of Haran, and his daughter-in-law Sarai, the wife of his son Abram, and together they set out from Ur of the Chaldeans to go to Canaan. But when they came to Haran, they settled there. Terah lived 205 years and he died in Haran. The Lord had said to Abram, "Go from your country, your people, and your father's household to the land I will show you. I will make you into a great nation, and I will bless you. I will make your name great, and you will be a blessing. I will bless those who bless you, and whoever curses you, I will curse. And all the peoples of earth will be blessed through you." So Abram went as the Lord had told him, and Lot went with him. Abram was 75 years old when he set out from Haran. He took his wife Sarai, his nephew Lot, all the possessions they had accumulated, and the people they had acquired in Haran, and they set out for the land of Canaan, and they arrived there. Abram travelled through the land as far as the site of the great tree of Moreh at Shechem. At that time, the Canaanites were in the land. The Lord appeared to Abram and said, "To your offspring I will give this land." So he built an altar there to the Lord who had appeared to him. From there he went towards the hills east of Bethel and pitched his tent, with Bethel on the west and Ai on the east. There he built an altar to the Lord and called on the name of the Lord. Then Abram set out and continued towards the Negev.
Trust, obey, and be a blessing. Trust, obey, and be a blessing. In the beginning, God created a wonderful world in which peace and harmony reigned. But tragedy struck. Human beings disobeyed God and ate forbidden fruit. Rather than trust God, they rebelled and put themselves in his place. They chose to determine for themselves good and evil. Judgment follows their rebellion, and humans are cast out of Eden. But in an act of grace, God clothes and cares for them. The early chapters of Genesis record one failure after another, and we see a repeating cycle of distrusting God, which leads to outright rebellion, which brings judgment, and then in God's mercy, a fresh act of grace. So we get this pattern of sin, judgment, grace. Sin, judgment, grace. Now, just before Abram, or Abraham as he is better known to us, appears on the scene, we read the story of the Tower of Babel. Humanity, in its arrogance, decides to make a great name for itself, to build a tower which will reach into the very heavens, literally putting themselves in God's place. In an act of judgment, God confuses their language and scatters them across the face of the earth. There is no new grace. It seems as if humanity will be left under God's judgment. But then, God speaks again, as he did at creation, with words of blessing. First for Abraham, and then through him for all the peoples on the earth. Now the Lord said to Abraham, "Go from your country, your kindred, and your father's house to the land that I will show you. I will give you descendants who shall become a great nation. I will make your name great. I will bless you." "Yes, Abraham, I know you don't know where the land is. I will show you. Will you trust me?" "Yes, I know that you and Sarah are old. Will you follow me?" "I know that there is much to fear in leaving behind your home and your family, but I will bless you. Will you trust me?" "If you trust me, obey me and go. I will, I will, I will." Trust. Isn't the fundamental question that humanity, that we always face, is whether or not to trust God? That was the choice put before Abraham, and it's also the one before us, you and me. Well, how do we learn to trust God? Well, what is trust? Let me ask you, whenever you're faced with a difficult situation or problem, to whom do you turn? Your spouse, family members, a friend? Why that person? It's because you trust them. You trust their judgment, and because of their track record, you trust their character. Trust means to place confidence in, to rely upon, to be secure in. And it's certainly easier to trust someone that you know well. And we'll only get to know the Lord well if we spend time with him, in prayer, reading the scriptures, and being gathered with others to worship him. Relationships don't work when they're one-sided, do they? I mean, that's obvious. So if we don't commit the time and energy to spend with the Lord, our relationship with him will never grow. At some point in our lives, each of us faces the decision to trust God, or maybe we face that decision repeatedly every day. Martin Luther says that faith is throwing yourself on God, and I really like that image because it conveys what it means to abandon our own desires and control and to trust the Lord instead for what is to come. We all get crunch moments. There are times when I've trusted and obeyed, and there are times when I haven't. But it's the same for all of us, isn't it? So let's be honest with ourselves about this. If we really trust the Lord, we will obey his will for our lives, because disobedience is the manifestation of distrust. And I'll say that again. Disobedience is the manifestation of distrust. Goodness, and don't we see that both in our own lives and across the whole sweep of human history? Just like Abraham's journey with the Lord, we have our ups and downs too. But when we walk with the Lord, no task is impossible and no failure is permanent. Abraham is regarded rightly as a hero of the faith, not because he was perfect, not because he always got it right, but because he believed and trusted in the promises of God and the God of promise. And I don't know about you, but I find that deeply comforting. In our passage, trust and obedience leads to blessing. In fact, the word bless is used 5 times and recalls God's blessing at creation. So blessing means fruitfulness, abundance, rest, harmony with God and with one another. That's what God wants for us, to be blessed, but also to be a blessing. So we trust, obey, and be a blessing. As we read through the book of Genesis, we can see a partial fulfillment of blessing for others through Abraham and his descendants. But Abraham's story is just the beginning of God's plan to overcome the curse of sin and bring universal blessing. His descendants become 12 tribes, then a nation, until almost 2,000 years after Abraham, we get to the one descendant through whom all God's promises to bless the nations will find their fulfillment. In the first verse of the Gospel of Matthew, we read, a record of the book of Jesus Christ, the son of David, the son of Abraham. The life, death, and resurrection of Jesus was the culmination of all those promises made so long before. After his baptism, Jesus began his journey of trust through the towns and villages of Galilee, healing, preaching hope, restoring outcasts. Jesus lived out what it means to be a blessing. Eventually, his faithful journey would lead him to Jerusalem, to the Garden of Gethsemane, where he would cry out, not my will, but yours be done. And then from Gethsemane to the cross. Jesus exemplifies and shows us perfectly what it means to trust, obey, and be a blessing. In faithfulness to his promises to bless all the peoples of the earth, at the cross, God gave up that which was most precious to him, his beloved Son. And now we are given a great commission to go out to all the nations and proclaim the good news of salvation and blessing. God has been faithful to his promises. God has been faithful to us. Will we be faithful to him? Just as I close, biblical names often have significant meanings. And Abraham, in our passage, pitched his tent between Bethel and Ai. Bethel means house of God, and Ai means ruins. As we go through each day, we are faced with a choice. Does our direction of travel take us towards the house of God or towards the place of ruin? For those are our only 2 choices. What will you choose? Maybe today can be a new beginning, a day to truly throw yourself on God, to heed his voice, to trust, obey, and be a blessing. Amen. As our response to the God who covenants and binds himself to us in love, it is only right that every blessing the Lord pours out, we turn back to praise. So let us sing, Blessed be your name.
Of abundance flow, blessed be your name. Blessed be your name when I'm found in the desert place, though I walk through the wilderness, blessed be your name. Every blessing you pour out, I'll turn back to praise. When the darkness closes in, Lord, still I will say, blessed be the name of the Lord, blessed be your name.
heart will choose to say, blessed be your name. You give and take away, you give and take away. Our heart will choose to say, blessed be your name. Blessed be the name of the Lord. Blessed be your name. Blessed be the name of the Lord. Blessed be your glorious name. Blessed be the name of the Lord. Blessed be your name. Blessed be the name of the Lord. Blessed be your glorious name.
My heart will choose to say, blessed be your name.
Having sung his praises, let us now declare together our faith in the risen Lord Jesus. Christ died for our sins in accordance with the scriptures. He was buried. He was raised to life on the third day. Afterwards, he appeared to his followers and to all the apostles. This we have received, and this we believe. Amen. And now Maura is going to come and bring us our intercessions.
Loving Father, we thank you that you always hear our prayers. Through faith in our Lord Jesus Christ, we can know your love and grace, and may that guide our lives. We ask for our sins to be forgiven. May we truly experience your forgiving love and reflect that love and mercy to others. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Lord, we pray for your church, giving thanks to those who witness to you in difficult and dangerous situations, remembering especially our mission partners in Paraguay and North Africa. We ask that your Holy Spirit protect and sustain them. Give us the courage to share your good news among family, friends, and colleagues. We pray for David, our bishop, and for Brian, Jonathan, and Frank, asking that in these challenging times, you will equip each of them with the wisdom, tools, and strength to serve your people. Protect us all, Lord, from being overwhelmed by life's problems, medical, relational, educational, work, or financial, looking to your Holy Spirit to guide us through each day, resting in your everlasting love. We pray for the home groups, that they may be a source of support and fellowship and encouragement as we meet to pray and study your word together. We thank you, Lord, for all who contribute to your church in Hillsborough, sustaining through prayer and bringing comfort to the sick, distressed, or lonely. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. We pray for those who are ill in hospital or at home, and those awaiting results or procedures. We ask that you may bring healing to the sick and sustain those who are now recovering. We ask, Lord, that those who are anxious, depressed, feeling isolated or grieving may know your peace in their hearts. And we think of our Queen Elizabeth at this time. We give thanks to all who care for them, the NHS staff, care workers, and family. Grant them the strength to face each new day, as well as the joy of knowing that they bring healing and comfort to those in their care. And we take a moment, Lord, to bring before you those who are particularly in our hearts today. Lord, we pray for your whole world, for governments near and far, who face difficult decisions about health, economy, and environment. May they act wisely and with integrity for the good of all people. We remember that as well as the challenges of COVID, many are facing the results of climate change, conflict, and government corruption. We pray for the thousands who suffer in poverty and the refugees trapped in camps across the world. We thank you for the work of many aid agencies, Christian Aid, Tear Fund, Habitat for Humanity, and Open Doors, to name just a few. And we pray, Lord, that in spite of reduced funding, they will continue to provide relief from suffering and offer sustainable solutions to communities that often lack clean water, shelter, medical facilities. May we continue to support them through our prayers and our giving. Lord, we thank you that you are the one who is always faithful and keeps your promises. Help us, through the power of your Holy Spirit, to trust and obey, that we may be a blessing in your world. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Before we come to our final song of praise, let me pray for you at home a final prayer of blessing. May the God of promise tenderly care for you, gather you in his arms, carry you close to his heart, and gently lead and guide you on your journey with him. And the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be with you and all those you love, this day and evermore. Amen. And our closing worship song is called Promises, because that's what our faithful God keeps.
my heart.